Good morning, everybody. Wave to let me know that you can actually hear me. There you go. And I want you all to take a look around on your gallery for Bev Butts. Notice that she has joined me in her car, or else a plane. Is it your car? Your car. Yeah. Okay. So it's wonderful that we can have church wherever we are, which also means you have no excuses anymore. You should be in church every Sunday, wherever you are. I do have a couple, as always, a couple tech notes to share with you. First of all, last week, they had changed some of the security functions on Zoom, and I was having problems with the muting, and I finally figured out what's going on. Zoom, in order to keep your ability to be private, has made it so that the host cannot unmute you without your permission. That's so that, like, if you're arguing on camera and we want to listen in, I can't just unmute you so that we can all hear what you're arguing about. Only you can give us permission to do that. So that means you are going to have to learn where that mute button is on your screen. And what we'll do during the prayer concerns and the announcements is the host and the co-host will ask you to unmute yourself, and then you have to actually unmute yourself. Okay, so that's why we had that. It's really to your benefit, but it's one additional step. Also, I want to welcome today Larry Casey as our co-host. We decided that John is also co-host, so both of them should be able to see that in their tech stuff. But Larry is going to be our primary co-host because we decided that we really needed to spread the knowledge. So today, as always, any technical problems are Larry's fault, not mine. So thank you, Larry, for doing that. He will be in charge of muting and unmuting you. We are hoping to install the broadband in the church center and in the church on June 18th. Is that right, John? Just nod. Yep. June 18th. So we're looking forward to that. Things are moving along. As always, there is a new Bible story available to the kids and to the adults who might want to listen to it. This is now beginning the stories in Exodus. So this is the story of Moses and the bulrushes, and that's available through our Facebook page and our podcast page. There will also be links on our website. After I'm done here, I'll put those links up. A book group is meeting Wednesday at noon, and we are starting a new book. We'll be meeting for a few weeks before summer break. So if I think most of you should have gotten that book through the mail. I have a couple of books that for some reason Amazon didn't want to deliver to those houses, and I will email you separately about getting those books to you. That's just a couple of them. So if you didn't get a book, you're probably one of those people on that list. June 21st, as I have mentioned, is going to be our modified Children's Day and Senior Recognition Service. So I'll let you know more about that next week, because hopefully I'll know more about that next week, but put that on your calendar. And mostly, need to know, today is communion. So if you didn't think to bring some sort of bread or crackers or something and something to drink, you will be able to get it and get that now so that you'll have it ready for everybody later in the service. Catherine Chambers wants to know what the book title is. I believe it's Seven Women and the Secret of Their Successful Faith or something like that. Something, I don't know, it's got seven chapters and it talks about seven women. So that's you. I can't tell you the titles of books as we're reading them. I can never remember what they are, but that's pretty close summation. Our June mission of the month, we are the first Sunday in June now. So our June mission of the month is Heart House. That's the hospice care house in Wellsville that our church has been very supportive of. And you can make a donation to that this month by writing a check to the church, or you can donate directly, but if you put it through the church, then we'll be able to know how many people in our congregation have supported that. I just want to mention about the mission of the month that most churches don't do this. In fact, I was talking with some people who said that the churches they had always gone to just gave to their general denominational funds. But the reason that we do this is because we like to support a lot of organizations that are out there doing good work, organizations that our own church people are involved in, but also by focusing on a mission every month, you get to know some of those organizations and the work that they do. So that's why we have the mission of the month for those who may be unfamiliar with that setup. And as always, I ask you to mail your offerings to Joan Bowden at 53 Sales Street. Are there other announcements? This is, you're on, Larry, now, so scroll through those screens, and if there's other announcements, just raise your hand and we will invite you to unmute yourself. Go ahead, Laurel.
We're going to have another painting of the trim in the sanctuary day on Thursday from like 8 to 11 or 12 in the morning. You don't have to paint, but if you enjoy sanding, we could use a lot of help with prep work. There's a lot of work. The windows are a little older and a little bit more beat up than what we had realized when we started this project. So we want to try to paint all the windows and the doorway inside the sanctuary over the course of maybe 4 or 5 mornings in the upcoming days. So we could use any help that anybody can give. Come in, drop out, whatever works.
You said that was Thursday at what? I'm sorry, you just muted yourself. Thursday at what time?
8. We'll start at 8 and go until close to noon.
Okay. So just drop by if you'd like to participate in that. They're also shining up all the brass plaques. I don't know if those are all finished or not, but if you like shining brass plaques, I'm sure there's more to be doing. So it's going to look really spiffy when we get back in there. Are there other announcements? If you're on a phone, you can press *9 in order to raise your hand. I'm not seeing any more. Larry, you seeing any? Okay, if we miss you, you can always put something in the chat. I am going to now pause the recording. Thank you. The Apostle Paul said, "We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed, persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed." We come to worship a God who invites us always to share in prayer our troubles, that we may be renewed in our faith, rekindle our hope in the future, and be strengthened in the love for one another that has sustained God's people in every generation. We come to worship a God who is a liberating God, who freed the people from slavery, who blessed the poor, who overturned the injustices of the powerful, and defeated even death and its allies to rise victorious to new life. We come to worship a God who invited all people to Christ's table, elevating no one person above another, but promising that all are equal in God's eyes. May we find in this worship guidance for our feet, focus for our minds, strength for our hearts, and hope and joy for our spirits to sustain us this day and in the days to come. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Our prayer of invocation today is by Howard Thurman. Lord, open unto me. Open unto me light for my darkness. Open unto me courage for my fear. Open unto me hope for my despair. Open unto me peace for my turmoil. Open unto me joy for my sorrow. Open unto me strength for my weakness. Open unto me wisdom for my confusion. Open unto me forgiveness for my sins. Open unto me tenderness for my toughness. Open unto me love for my hates. Open unto me thyself for myself. Lord, Lord, open unto me. Let's take a few moments in silent prayer, coming before God and opening our hearts so that God may enter in. Let us pray silently. God, hear these prayers and hear us as we lift our voices as one congregation, saying the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our lay leader for today is Alicia.
This week's scripture reading comes from 2 Corinthians 4, verses 7 through 10. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies.
Thank you, Alicia. The hymn for today is "For the Healing of the Nations," and the words are probably in your chat. I don't have my chat up. It's also in your hymnal if you have hymnals at home, number 428. And again, you're going to have to listen to me sing, so please sing really loud so that you can't hear me. Here we go.
Lord, we pray with one accord for a just and equal sharing of the things that earth affords to a life of
Well done. Will you join me now in saying our prayers together? When I say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. Let us bow our heads in prayer. God of compassion, whose heart envelops all of the world in this difficult time, we ask you to grant us the strength not only to endure these hard times, but to direct our energies toward the care of others as we seek out acts of creativity, celebrate beauty, and look for hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. This week, God, we pray for those who are on the front lines of the fight against injustice. Your son Jesus placed his physical well-being on the line for others and knew what it was to be beaten and mistreated at the hands of the powerful. We pray for those in our communities and our churches who likewise are marching and peacefully protesting on behalf of racial justice. We ask that you give them courage and keep them safe. May all of us find ways to speak out against injustice and work in our lives to make our society a place of peace for all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask, Lord, that you come to those who are beset by illness, who struggle with the physical disabilities of chronic disease, mental illness, or face anxiety and depression exacerbated by these difficult times. May they find rest and relief in you and in the care of this community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. May we take heart in the beauty of the earth and be lifted by the continuance of life in the natural world around us. As we listen to the song of the birds and work in the warm soil of our gardens, may we have a sense of your creating presence by our sides. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us, God, for the times in this past week when we have given into our despair and hunkered down in self-pity, when we have spoken impatiently to another, or when we've been too quick to speak our judgment and too slow to listen. Help us to find rest in your healing mercy and restore us, forgive us, and help us to be better people tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we pray once again that you be with our leaders, both our elected officials and with the individuals who have risen to positions of influence. May they speak wisely and make wise decisions that will unite our communities and move us as a nation closer to peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray today for those in our own families, our churches, our communities, whose names we have shared during prayer concerns, or whose names we keep in our hearts, but who are grieving for loved ones died, who are facing economic insecurity, who are in isolation, feeling alone, who are in need of healing in body, mind, and spirit. Lord, be with them and help us to find ways of bringing comfort to one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray finally, as we do every week for ourselves, that we may have patience with one another in these stressful times, that we may look for opportunities to create beauty and spread joy and hope, that we may work for the common good, be steadfast in love, walk steadfastly in faith, and always cultivate peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, accept these prayers as a sign of our desire to be at one with you and at one with each other, living out our lives in peace and compassion as Christ has called us to live. In his name we pray. Amen. The second scripture reading today is from the book of Acts. I have been reflecting throughout the book of Acts, and we come towards the end of Acts as Paul is preparing to leave for Jerusalem. He suspects that in Jerusalem, he will be, just as Jesus was, arrested and put on trial by authorities. And so he delivers these final words to his friends at Ephesus, knowing what might lay ahead for him. From Miletus, Paul sent a message to Ephesus, asking the elders of the church to meet with him And when they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the entire time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears, enduring the trials that came to me through the plot of the Judaizers. I did not shrink from doing anything helpful, from proclaiming the message to you and teaching you publicly, and from house to house as I testified to both Jews and Greeks about repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus. And now, as a captive of the Spirit, I am on my way to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and persecutions are waiting for me. But I do not count my life of any value to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the good news of God's grace." These past months have been difficult for all of us. But I know from my conversations with them that it has been especially hard on our youth and our young people. The pandemic was hard enough as they were suddenly isolated from friends and lost the independence that's so important at their age. But now, watching our communities torn with strife and the violence of injustice has been heart-wrenching. So this morning, I want to address my thoughts to the young people of our church. And I'm going to follow Paul's example, and I'm going to put my thoughts in the form of a letter. If you're older, you can listen, but this letter is not for you. This letter is for all of our young people, for all of you who have ever been in youth group, played Foursquare with me, gone on field trips with me, cleaned creeks, eaten pizza, debated scruples questions, and discussed theology and the meaning of life with me. I'm writing this letter to you because I know that you are as heartbroken as I am by the events in our country. And I feel such sorrow on your behalf. You shouldn't have to be carrying the burden of so much brokenness at a time when your lives are supposed to be full of only joy and potential and excitement about the future. Instead, we are together watching our world fall apart. And none of us is sure how we are going to put it back together. And I don't really have any more answers than anyone else does for you. But as a minister who has walked with a lot of people through the brokenness of their lives and helped them to find a way back toward healing, I have learned a few things that might help you to persevere in these unfathomably hard times. And the first thing is, let yourself be angry and sad and confused. The power of our feelings can be overwhelming, and we can be tempted to try to escape them because they can hurt so much. But if instead we give ourselves permission to go ahead and weep and keen our anger to the heavens, those feelings will eventually strengthen us instead of depleting us. This is the time to let our emotions be raw and express the depth of our human heartache. The only people who are not weeping these days are those who gave up on humanity a long time ago, whose dry eyes say in effect, "What else did you expect?" Your tears are an expression of your hope. They are a sign that you still believe that the world doesn't have to be unjust and cruel. So accept the weight of your anguish as the sign of the depth of your caring heart. And when that burden becomes too much to bear, throw all of that anger and grief onto God. Don't hold back. You can even use profanity. You have my permission. If that's the only way that you can express to God the depth of those feelings, prayers aren't supposed to be pretty, and our words to God aren't supposed to be safe and polite. God can take it. God wants to take it. It isn't just nice theology when the Bible says, "Surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows." Those words are the lifeline of our faith, because God promises to give us the help that we need to bear the unbearable. Secondly, trust that the crisis and the turmoil that we are going through right now is also a sign of hope. You know, we human beings don't like to change. God knows we don't like to change. And I mean, God knows. The Bible is one story after another of God trying to convince people to change, people ignoring God's plea, and then crisis ensuing. The Pharaoh of Egypt didn't just wake up one day and say, you know, this whole system of slavery is unjust, so I'm going to let the Israelites go. Pharaoh's world had to be turned upside down before he let the people have their freedom. And even after he let the Israelites go, he changed his mind and he tried to drag them back so that things could be the way they had been. God had to part the waters of the Red Sea before the Israelites could finish their walk to freedom. It would be great if human beings could easily accept new ways of thinking and living together, but most of us would rather be comfortable than be just. And the older people get, the more entrenched we become in the way things are. The broiling cruelties and anger and hatreds and threats that are consuming our communities right now really aren't new. They've been there for a long time. But too many people cherished their comfort and their order so much that they were willing to ignore those injustices. And the pain of these days is a hopeful sign that maybe finally the waters are parting, and that no one will be able to drag us back to the calm of an unjust order. I pray that this crisis will not pass quickly, because crisis is God's way and has always been God's way of lighting a fire under the comfortable and the complacent. And finally, when all of the emotions of the moment have burned out and most people have gone back to the ordinary concerns of their lives, I hope that you will never accept again that ordinary is good enough. I hope that you will allow these times to shape who you are and who you will be and commit yourself for the long haul. When the Apostle Paul talks about the life of faith in his letters, he often describes it as running a race, and he wasn't talking about a sprint or a relay race. He was talking about a marathon. Some older people think that at certain time in their lives, they can pass the baton to the younger generation as if this is a relay race. But Paul makes it clear that we don't finish the course until we take our last breath. So you can trust, I am still in this race with you. You can trust that when you are feeling alone and unsure of whether you can stay the course, you can look around and see a whole church full of creaky, battle-scarred old folk who are still in this race with you. We may be a little worse for the wear, but we have learned things over the years that will help you as well in this marathon. We have learned how to hold one another up during these times when our legs are so tired and our hearts so full of despair that we're not sure we can keep going. We have learned how to seek moments of joy in the midst of sadness and cherish glimpses of beauty in the midst of ugliness so that we will remember what it is we're fighting for. And we've learned how to lean on God in prayer when we need more than human strength to keep going. But most of all, we have learned how much we need you. How much we need the hope that your tears and your anger and your passion and your insight give us. So in the end, I guess, What I most want to say to you in this letter is thank you. Thank you for those tears. Thank you for your anger. Thank you for your insistence that we can all be better than what we have been. Thank you for joining the race. May the God of love and peace be with you and with all of us. Signed, Lori. I invite all of you now to come to Christ's table, where when you are afraid, you can find courage to love. When you are filled with doubt, you can find faith. When you despair, you can find hope. And when you're tired and torn, you can be assured that here, God can make you whole again. Hear these words of institution as written by Paul the Apostle in his letter to the Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us prepare our hearts by listening to the prayer of thanksgiving. Alicia, please do a prayer over the bread and the cup.
Infinite Spirit, bless these elements as an indelible symbol of your everlasting love. As we partake of the bread and the cup in remembrance of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, may we be children of the light and affirm in all ways our belonging to one humanity. In truth, we are all brothers and sisters in this shared existence. Lord, renew in us the resolution to cast out from ourselves the instincts of separateness and selfishness, so that we may more effectively come alongside one another in solidarity to build a more just and equitable world. May we be nourished by the sacred mysteries of holy sacrifice, and be lifted to embody the divine love of Christ, being ever mindful of its indwelling presence in our lives on earth. Amen.
Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Everyone may eat of the bread of life. Jesus said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you." For our closing prayer, I'd like to read to you a prayer by Howard Thurman again. If you'd like to read along, you can, or you can just listen. Our little lives, our big problems, these we place upon your altar, God. The quietness in your temple of silence again and again rebuffs us. For some, there is no discipline to hold them steady in the waiting, and the minds reject the noiseless invasion of your spirit. For some, there is no will to offer what is central in the thoughts. The confusion is so manifest, there is no starting place to take hold. For some, the evils of the world tear down all concentrations and scatter the focus of the high resolves. We do not know how to do what we know to do. We do not know how to be what we know to be. Our little lives, our big problems, these we place upon your altar. Pour out upon us whatever our spirits need of shock, of life, of release, that we may find strength for these days, courage and hope for tomorrow. In confidence, we rest in your sustaining grace, which makes possible triumph in defeat, gain in loss, and love in hate. We rejoice this day to say, our little lives, our big problems, these we place upon your altar. Amen. And now, deep peace of the quiet earth to you, deep peace of the singing brook to you, deep peace of gentle hearts to you, deep peace of the light of the world to you. Go in peace, now and forever. Amen.